أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله لا إله إلا الله
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة أيها الأخوة والأخوات من أعظم آيات الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن وفي سنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وكذلك في الإنجيل والتوراة وغيره الشمس والقمر فلذلك إذا وجدنا في تاريخ البشر وجدنا أقوام يتبعون مناهج يعبدون الشمس فيه فلذلك في تاريخنا وسيرة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم نهى النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام في الصلاة في بعض الأوقات منه الأوقات الذي يغرب الشمس قبل ذلك بقليل فإنها كانت وقت يتبعونها عبدة الشمس فلذلك بين الله سبحانه وتعالى توضيحا واضحا فقال ومن آياته الشمس والقمر لا تسجدوا للشمس ولا للقمر واسجدوا لله الذي خلقهن إن كنتم إياه تعبدون Brothers and sisters, respected elders, One of the known as manifested symbols that has been a topic of immense discussion, writings, philosophy, theology, has been the ordinance of this vast dominion that we live in, particularly the planetary elements with emphasis upon the sun itself, S-U-N. And in that context, you find throughout history pockets of populations that chose over time to worship this magnificent element. And this approach to worship and this approach to belief that indeed the sun is that greater being, you find voices, replications in the Quran about that type of philosophy, of people that hold fast to that type of philosophy. You find replications, reverberations in the Torah and also in the New Testament, for example, of Jesus, peace and blessings of God be upon him, attributed to Jesus, the first four Gospels, particularly Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and other faiths, other perspectives, other methodologies as well, outside of those Abrahamic faiths. And as a result, you find reverberations of this concept at the time of Prophet, for example, when he is discussing with his companions about time frames that people should take into consideration, not to necessarily make this particular time a time of a particular devoutness, because there have been people who took this time, particularly, for example, sunset, when the sun is swooning away in the presence of the people, this amazing thing that is occurring, the thing that lights up the sky, people chose to worship particularly at that time. So the message in monotheistic perspective was a message of understanding. You understand that there are people that do so, but at the same time, the reflection upon the soul. So the verses were recited that among the signs of God is the sun, from among the signs of God is the moon. But these are elemental aspects that are part of the design, but they themselves are not the designer. So as a result, humility, wholehearted humility, ought be towards this immaculate being who is the designer of these particular things. Prostration, humility, among other things. But this as a symbol of power and honor is true. But is this power and honor in of itself powerful and honorable because of its preeminent being, or because of that which was placed into it by this preeminent being? فسبحان الخالق سبحانه وتعالى الذي ذكر آيات كثيرة متعلقة بهذا الباب. وفي عصر النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام كما تعرفون كان بعض الناس عند العرب في الحجاز يظنون أن الشمس إذا خسفت معنى ذلك أن رجلا عظيما مات أو ولد. فسبحان الذي دبر الأحوال أن في سنة من السنين مات إبراهيم رضي الله تعالى عنه، وبعضهم يقولون عليه السلام، عن ابن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، ففي نفس اليوم خسفت الشمس. فبعض الناس قالوا أنها خسفت من أجل موت إبراهيم رضي الله تعالى عنه. فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كما روي مالك بن أنس رحمه الله تعالى عن هشام بن عروة عن عروة بن الزبير عن عائشة أن النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام ذهب للمسجد وصلى ركعتين، أولاهما طال في القيام ثم دخل في الركوع ثم قام من الركوع فطال في القيام مرة أخرى وقرأ قرآنا ثم ذهب للركوع مرة أخرى ثم قام بعد ذلك ثم دخل في السجود فصارت الركعة معها ركوعين، ثم قال وفعل ذلك مرة أخرى، وبعد ما انتهى من الصلاة قام وخطب فأثنى على الله سبحانه وتعالى بما هو أهله سبحانه، ثم قال بعد ذلك إن الشمس والقمر آيتان من آيات الله لا يخسفان لموت أحد ولا لحياته، فإذا رأيتم ذلك فصلوا وادعوا وتصدقوا، ثم قال يا أمة محمد لو تعلمون ما أعلم وضحكتم قليلا ولبكيتم كثيرا. So what had happened was the concept of solar eclipses and lunar eclipses that would shadow this magnificent thing that follows us everywhere during the daytime, so it seems, occurs quite often than people presume. What is very unique about the solar eclipse in our area is that it is a total solar eclipse. That means that the sun will be blocked out. Because of the precision of its size, the distance to the moon, and our presence here on Earth, so these planetary objects had connected. So it allows for the sun to be completely blocked out. It's called a total solar eclipse. This is unique. The last time something like that really was a total solar eclipse, arguably in this type of area, was in around 1918, approximately, a little bit later than that, in the 30s. So it's been some time. So when this thing happens, and or in history, people used to take it as a tremendous awe, completely different, something that is transcends normality. And there have been people that have attributed a religiousness to it when it comes to an eclipse, for example. Some of those reverberations actually also appeared and reappeared at the time of Muhammad with his companions that were around him, his disciples. And it so happened that there was a solar eclipse. And in that solar eclipse, it so happened that same day the son of Muhammad passed away, named as Abraham. His name was Abraham. Passed away. So some people, they said the reasoning for this solar eclipse was because the death of the son of Muhammad. So they used to attribute the connectedness to a birth of a very honorable person or the death of a very honorable person. So they said it occurred because of his death. So what happened was a narration that was occurred at the time. Muhammad, during the solar eclipse, alayhi salatu wasalam, he goes to the mosque and he begins to pray. And in his prayer, he does the regulatory formalities of a unit of prayer, but he increases each unit of prayer with one additional action or two, namely the ruku'. So there'd be two ruku's, one unit of prayer, etc. He finishes his prayer. He gets up and he speaks to the people. And he tells them that the sun and the moon in of itself are manifestations of a greater message for the human race. But it does not fall into a solar eclipse or fall into a state of an eclipse because of the life of anybody or the death of anybody. Then he goes on to explain a little bit more. And he goes into some depth, and one of the things he mentions in this time period, because people are in, you know, a type of hesitation, something very unique at that time, especially at that time. And he tells them something which is interesting. You find this statement actually reverberated also in the messages of Jesus in his various books that are attributed to him, and also in the Old Testament, that if you knew what I know, the relaxation of life wouldn't be as relaxed. And those aspects of relaxation in which we tend to fall into to immense relaxation wouldn't necessarily be your greater goal. Because of the hidden knowledges they claim to have and hold, a deeper meaning of things to come, among other things as well. قُلُوا قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على من بعث رحمة للعالمين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. فكان مذهب الفقهاء في خسوف الشمس أن يصلون ويستغفرون ويدعون الله سبحانه وتعالى ومذاهبهم شتى منه الركوعين في ركعة وهو الذي انتشر في الحجاز أهل الكوفة كانوا يصلون ركعتين مثل النوافل وبعد ما ينتهون من الصلاة يرفعون أيديهم في الدعاء ويبقون على ذلك. فالسؤال لماذا يفعلون ذلك؟ لماذا أوصان النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام في مثل ذلك الأوقات؟ لا شك أنها من آيات الله التي تعودنا أنفسنا إليه فتغيرت الظروف وبعض العلماء يقولون أنها نموذجة لما ستحصل في المستقبل، أعني في يوم القيامة. قول الله سبحانه وتعالى: إذا الشمس كورت. قال عبد الله بن عباس ومجاهد وحسن وقتادة وغيرهم، يعني ذهبت النور، يذهب النور منه إذا الشمس كورت. وسبحان الذي قد ذكر ذلك في التوراة كذلك، في كتب التوراة، أن من علامات الساعة وغير أو في الساعة يوم القيامة يخرج نور الشمس، حتى في كتاب متى الذي يروون عن عيسى عليه السلام في فصل 24 يذكر علامات الساعة، ومن علاماته يقول: ويخسف الشمس إذا الشمس كورت. ثم بعد ذلك يقول في أثناء أقواله، يسألونه متى ستحصل هذا الأمر، قال: لا أدري، لا يعرفون متى هو، لا ملك مقربا ولا الإبن إلا الخالق سبحانه وتعالى. So what's interesting is that the paranoia that is connected to the eclipses that happen in a historical sense, particularly an emphasis in Islamic philosophy, is that symbolic gesture that it does to the human being. Because we have adapted ourselves to normalities. Every day in the morning, we're not worried that the sun will appear. Every day in the morning, we don't go and press a button to turn on the sun. But we have made it a normality. It is normative. It is always there. It is always part of us. We don't think twice about its existence to come. In the context of this, when things change from a normative state, it's basically an opportunity for the person to reflect upon deeper meaning, much deeper meaning, deeper thoughts. That normativeness has changed. And hopefully it's an opportunity to realize that things don't remain, and things also will eventually change. And that in actuality, it gives a representation that actually there is a limitation to ourselves. So now I wake up in the morning, and the thing that is normative is not so normative. There is a tremendous influx of visitors to the Willamette Valley, particularly because of something different that is happening, a change to normality, a change to these elements. Furthermore, the concept of things to come, when you think of eschatology, known as eschatology, وعلامات الساعة وغير آخر الأيام وغير ذلك, eschatology, in the book of Matthew, chapter 24, eschatology, references of eschatology, in the book of Daniel, references of Job, etc., eschatology, a things to come. And from that concept of eschatology is that reference about, in this time period, this sun that is normative is not so normative. There becomes an alteration to that existence of light, the swooning of the light, for example, that is mentioned in these references. So now in Islamic philosophy, this thing is an observation that hopefully these normalities that change and you have adapted yourself to causes you to humble yourself, to place you in a state that is different, to place you in a state that you realize that actually I'm actually in need, whereas previously it's very probable that you never thought you were in need. Need of drink? Yes, I have drink, I have the money to get so. But now there is something greater, I'm in need of something greater. Placing someone into check, which as a result ought make a person extremely sincere. Extremely sincere. فنحن حينما نتحدث عن الدعاء مثلا كلنا نعلم إذا احتاجنا شيئا حينما نصلي نصلي كأننا واقفين أمام الله سبحانه وتعالى فعلا ودعاؤنا من القلب ولكن الأيام العادي من الذي يدعي هكذا يعني مخلصا من قلبه؟ فحينما نحن نتحدث عن خسوف الشمس نتحدث عن أمور كثير من آيات الله سبحانه وتعالى وغيره، ولكن في نفس الوقت يخوف أن يتواضع العباد من أجله ينتقلون من الكبر إلى المتواضع إذا كانوا مخلصين، إذا تدبروا هذا الأمر إدبارا مخلصا من الله سبحانه وتعالى. فلذلك يذكر عن بعض العلماء حينما يتحدثون عن الدعاء في السفر علامات الاستجابة، لأن الرجل متعب في حال التعب، تغيرت الظروف في الوطن مرتاح، في السفر يتعب النفس. يروى عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إن السفر قطعة من العذاب. في ذلك الروايات في السنن دعاء المسافر المستجاب، هل هي المطلوب وراء ذلك أو القصد وراء ذلك لأن السفر بعينه، أم الذي تحصل للقلب في ذاك الوقت؟ فقد يكون أن الرجال يسافرون ولكن نيتهم في السفر هي المعاصي أو الفساد، فلا يحصل هذا التغيير في القلب. ولكن الذي يسافر مخلصا لله وفي أمور مباح وهو مخلص لله وفي تغيير القلب أنه تعب في السفر، فإذا يحس فعلا أنه لابد أن يتضرع لله سبحانه وتعالى فتكون مستجابة. نعم. يصيبه فقر شديد، علامات الاستجابة. المظلوم لأنه يعلم أن فعلا لا يوجد حول ولا قوة إلا من الله، فيدعي الله سبحانه، فيروى أنه الدعاء مستجاب له، دعوة المظلوم ليس بينه وبين الله حجاب. نحن نسمعها كثيرا، لحضر القلب الذي هو فيه مهم جدا. So what you find is this concept of humility and its effects upon the soul. You find a tremendous emphasis about that, that in our normative state we tend to forget things. In our health, at times we assume ourselves self-sufficient, or unlimited. Right? When we are rich, we don't assume or think twice about the possibility of a rainy day, for example, among other things. But when those things happen, and this exterior things affects the soul, a person becomes very humble, and that heart, spiritual heart per se, becomes humiliated. Not in a necessary negative sense, but they realize that actually there is something. I need help. It's simple. I am actually weak. So you find in the Bible, for example, Job, Yunus, for example, and you find it in the Quran as well. Humbled, difficult state. فَنَادَى فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ أَن لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ فَاسْتَجَابَ لَهُ. So they call out in this humbled state. Sickness is there. Difficulty is there. So these reverberations in the Islamic text about changings of your normative state being a means that hopefully the supplication, the sincerity is even more, you can say, we don't say powerful, but it reaches God in a fashionable manner, a unique manner. A person who travels, in that state fatigue happens. So when you have humbled yourself, you are fatigued. That supplication changes. You really mean that you need help, you know, you're fatigued. When you become sick, that circumstance of arrogance changes. You realize that actually sickness is very difficult. I take medicine and hopefully it's going to make things better, but I still have to go through the process. So as a result, you say, oh yeah, Allah, for example. You start to supplicate. And many of us know what happens on airplanes. It starts to shake. If it becomes really serious, they realize there's nothing, you know. If you're out there, someone help me. So the heart changes, the circumstance changes. And as a result, you find that reference when it comes to the solar eclipse, Prophet ﷺ's statement, that to make supplication to that time, because there's hopefully, in a sincere cause, the heart changes during that time. A person can travel, and it could be for negativity. The traveling of itself doesn't change the heart. It's the effects upon the heart that hopefully changes, that humbles the person. فالنبي عليه الصلاة والسلام يقول في الحديث المشهور إن الله طيب لا يقبل إلا طيبا وإن الله أمر المؤمنين بما أمر به المرسلين فقال تعالى يا أيها الرسل كلوا من الطيبات واعملوا صالحا وقال تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا كلوا من طيبات ما رزقناكم ثم ذكر الرجل أشعث أغبر يمد يديه إلى السماء يا رب يا رب ومطعمه حرام ومشربه حرام وملبسه حرام وغذي بالحرام فأنى يستجاب لذلك كيف يستجاب لذلك. فالشاهد أشعث أغبر في السفر، أشعث أغبر يمد يديه إلى السماء يا رب يا رب، لأن الأشعث الأغبر ليست المطلوب منا لا نمشي شعراتنا ولا نلبس الأواعي الجميل، إن الله جميل يحب الجمال، ولكن غيرت الأحوال. فالآن الرجل يريد مساعدة، فحضرت القلب. ولكن قد يكون في بعض العلل، لباسه حرام، ألبسه حرام، غذي بالحرام، فإن يستجاب لذلك. فلذلك مثلا عبد الله بن عمر يرى عنه فيما أذكر أن رجل سأله مسألة فجاوبه وقال كأن الرجل الذي يسرق الجمل من الذي يحجون للحج ثم يستعملها للجهاد، كيف يستجاب لذلك؟ وقال سعيد بن المسيب حينما سئل عن اللقطة الذي يجبها الرجل في الطريق يأخذها ويتصدق به، هل يؤجر لذلك؟ قال كيف يؤجر لذلك وأن هذا ليست له. فكيف إذن الغذية بالحرام، أكل في الحرام، والشراب من الحرام، وكل ذلك من الحرام، فأنا يستجاب لذلك؟ ما معنى ذلك أنها لا يقبل مطلقا؟ معناها في تأثير قوة الدعاء، مع أن الرجل أشعث أغبر، متواضع، خلاص يعلم هو عند الله سبحانه وتعالى. فلذلك نقول يا رب ونستغفر الله ثم ننتقل إلى الدعاء، كما كان مذهب كثير من الصالحين وغيرهم. So you found a very powerful prophetic tradition in the concept, the context that we are speaking of at this point. God is different, is unique, does not have any negativity. طيب. You find people who translate it mean to be pure. It's a deeper meaning, which brings us to light about the question of translations out there to be aware. Goes on to explain that he accepts as a regulatory practice of appreciation, goodness, things that are of purity, sincerity, among other things. Then it goes into depth. Skipping some formalities of reaching the point, then he mentions, he describes a scenario of a person, أشعث أغبر. A person, for example, is a traveler, among other things, and his clothing is detest. Right? His face is dirty, his hands is dirty, his hair is not combed, among other things. So he's in difficulty. And we spoke of previously that in humility, the heart becomes even more sincere because they realize their weakness. And as a result, he starts to make supplication to God. He needs help, and he starts to make supplication to God. But the reality is, the state of ourselves, is that by itself what makes things different? The state of ourselves, is that by itself what makes a supplication to God accepted? So he goes on to explain how powerful, how unique, how really sincere would that supplication be, whereas he has been unjust to himself, unjust in the way he receives wealth, sustenance, for example, maybe through transgression. Sustenance, the things he eats, among other things. People have forgotten about these unique attributes, scenarios, things that they are in. So the portion of the observation in this philosophy is that even if a person has good intention but the means is extremely negative, a person really needs to reevaluate that approach to this particular thing. Like a person, for example, Abdullah ibn Umar talks of a person who steals a traveling kit from people that are performing the pilgrimage, then uses it in a cause for God. He says, where is the justification behind that? The justification behind that. فَكَانَ الدُّعَاءَ يَا إِخْوَانِي عَلَى مَذَاهِبٍ مِنْهُ وَنَّ يَرْفَعَ الْأَصْوَى فَيَدْعِ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى الأوزعي كان يفعل ذلك ويرى ذلك في صلاة القنوت، يعني في الدعاء القنوت في الصلاة بالأصبع، يرفع الأصبع. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يروى عنه أنه كان يرفع الأصبع في الدعاء في المنبر حينما يخطب للناس يوم الجمعة. ومذاهب أخرى أنه يرفع اليده ويكون ظاهر الكفين للقبلة، أو ظاهر الكفين للسماء، أو داخل الكفين للسماء وظاهرها للأرض، غير ذلك. مذاهب حسب الظروف. ولكن كما تعرفون إذا ما رفع يده أو ما أشار بأصبعه أو أنه أشار بأصبعه أو رفع يده ولكن لا يوجد إخلاص ولا متواضع لله ولا غير ذلك، فأنا يستجاب لذلك، معنى ينقص قوة الدعاء بنفسه، ينقص بنفسه قوة الدعاء بذلك الأمر. So a person in the approach to supplication, you find actions, approaches to it, historically in the various religious practices, raising the finger, supplication, the hands, supplication, other religious practices that they have in supplication. Prophet ﷺ, he had different formalities for it, but the question behind that is what we should take into consideration. These things represent something that is slightly deeper. When a person raises his hand like this and the palms are to the head, it means you need help, you need help. You see, we find at times older individuals, when something bad happens, they raise their hands and say, God forbid. They're trying to push something away, symbolic of that which is in the heart. Symbolic of that which is in the heart. You find people raise their finger in their supplication. Symbolic of that oneness in the heart, among other things. These formalities we pay so much attention to of our actions of our limbs. This is just an agent. If we don't use those actions of our limbs in the supplication, God doesn't hear that supplication or the sincerity or the call for help. Of course He does. That remains His attribute of the Sami', the one who hears. But the question again in the context of what we are discussing is, how sincere is the person in this circumstance? How unique is the person in this circumstance? How humble is the person in this circumstance? And when a solar eclipse happens, what type of effect does it have upon the person and their soul? إخواني لا تنسونا أن مذهب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في الخسوف أن يدعي الله سبحانه وتعالى يستغفر الله سبحانه وتعالى يعطي الصدقات. كان بعض الفقهاء يرون قد يكون أن الخسوف, أنا أعني في التاريخ, يعني مثلا في كتاب 24 من مجموع الفتاوى التقي والدين ابن تيمية, هو كان يقول أن خسف الشمس حينما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يخوف الله به عباده, معنى قد يكون أن إشارة لما قد يكون فيه فساد في الأرض, أو أن ربما في المستقبل تحصل شيئا, ولكن من أجل هذا الخوف والتغيير القلوب والدعاء لله يرفع الله سبحانه وتعالى أمور لا نعرفه, هو الذي يعرفه سبحانه وتعالى على الناس, هو الذي يرفع. ونحن نؤمن أن الله هو الرحمن الرحيم, وقد رفع أمور كثير لا ندري ما هو, والناس الذي هم فيه الآن رفع الله سبحانه وتعالى أكثر من ذلك بكثير لا نحصيه ولا ندري ما هو. فالدعاء والتواضع وكل ذلك يغير الظروف, لا شك في ذلك. People look around in life and they see corruption here, negativity there, unfortunate circumstances here and there, and they start to question, you know, where is God? How could this be allowed? Among other things as well. In the context of our discussion, the concept of a person humbling themselves and praying and asking for help, among other things, supplications, there are things that are of the unseen world. This is what some Islamic theologians they propose. That God is not an oppressor, nor is He a corrupter, nor does He want to hurt people. Many things that did not happen because of the goodness of God and the goodness of people, among other things as well. We don't see many things. There's things of the unworld, unseen world, but there are things that we have capability and choice of, and through our actions, negativity happens. And we can't blame it on anyone except yourself. فَلَا يَلُومُونِي وَلَمُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ مَا نَبِي مُصْرِخِكُمْ وَلَا أَنتُمْ مُصْرِخِينَ. And it's you chose these things to do. Solar eclipse happens, hopefully it has an effect on our heart, taken into consideration the context of the things that are before us. Hopefully it humbles us, hopefully it keeps us humble, humility, and it gives us a chance to think about deeper things. That really, there's a deeper thing out there, that's one thing for sure, and it's far different and or far greater than our own capabilities. Allah Ta'ala A'lam, Rabbana Atina fi dunya hasana fi al-akhirati hasana wa qina adhab an-nar. Rabbana hab lana min azwajina wa dhurriyyatina qurrata a'yun waj'alna lil-muttaqina imama. Rabbana la tuzigh qulubana ba'da idh hadaytana wa hab lana min ladunka rahma innaka antal wahhab. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun al-mursalin walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.